Thank you. Hey, good day, everybody. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Yes, I want to welcome you to the celebration service of our late brother, Arnold Richard Charles. And my task today is to coordinate the tributes. So just before we do that, let's just sing one verse of that song. One verse of the same song. I need the prayers of those I love. To some special tributes at this time. And the first that we have on the list is Mr. Mosley Cato. If you are here with us, you can please come on.
Good morning, church. My name is Mosley Cato, and I grew up with Arnold from toddler. We were toddlers together. I actually lived in Hopewell, close to Arnold. And there were four little boys in that area, the same age at the time. It was myself, Arnold, young Mr. Paris, and Joseph Hercules. We were not as privileged as Arnold was, but we had more time on our hand than Arnold did. So Arnold always wanted to join with the boys and play, but he was a little bit restricted. So we set ourselves up to one person would be keeping an eye on Mrs. Charles. One would be looking in the direction of Arnold, and one would be looking over at Mr. Joe Cupid, Orange Tree. So we knew how to coordinate. But Arnold always let me know that he is my senior. That one bothered me for a while. I couldn't understand why he was saying that. When we rekindled, when Arnold went to Marcus Secondary School, we were in the same form. And then I realized that Arnold had just a few days on me. That made him my senior. We always had a laugh. Arnold was a prankster. And I have never, ever seen Arnold frowned. We did a book called Good News for Modern Men. It was Bible teachings, but it had a lot of sketches. Arnold would make fun of the sketches in class. And when Sister Gabrielle turned around, Arnold had the most serious face. But that was the Arnold. He was a good cricketer, right? And His father, who called Arnold Biebs, he supported Arnold. He wanted Arnold to be an island cricketer. So he bought all the gears that Arnold needed and everything. And he sent Arnold off to meet Mike Finley at Arnoldsville. Arnold had a hard time getting home from school, getting the gears together, and wait for Edgerton to take him down to the park at Arnoldsville. So Mr. Charles made it easier for Arnold. He bought a car for Arnold. He would say it's his car, but he bought that car for Arnold. But they didn't want Arnold to have too much outside company. So Arnold would let me know, I'm going home, I get in my gears, I get in the car, wait for me by Bennett. So I would wait here, and we would ride into Arnoldsville. He would set himself up, get himself ready, and we would wait for Mike Finley. I would sit outside, and I would look at Arnold bat. He was a good wicketkeeper too. But the boys from the Kingston, Arnoldsville, Kingston area, when they made a beautiful stroke, you heard a lot of but when Arnold from the Mariqua area made a beautiful stroke, you hardly hear anything. So Arnold asked me, man, when me hit the ball, man, you must clap. So when he hit the ball or played a nice stroke, I would. Arnold told me the evening, that's not enough. You have to. So I have to clap plenty. That was my friend. When my father passed, I saw another side of Arnold. We had a little gathering around at my place at Canyon. And I saw Arnold dancing. I've never seen Arnold dance. So I turned around and I looked at him like, you for real? And Arnold looked at me, I'm having a good time. Now your daddy we dead. So I said, yes, it's my father. But you dancing? And I looked at me and he said, if it was you, me not only been a dance, me been a way red to celebrate your life. Today, we are not mourning Arnold's passing. We are celebrating his life. Arnold lived a good life. Arnold was always willing to say something good to somebody in distress. He was willing to help with a smile. I went away for 35 years, and I kept in touch with Arnold by mail and later down by phone. When I came back here, it was the same jovial, fun-loving Arnold. Had something good to say to everybody and about everybody. It was rather shocking. I was at the store sometime and somebody came and they told me, Arnold passed, you know. I asked, who Arnold? You know, when you get these kind of messages for the first minute, the shock of it, they said, your friend Arnold. And I just bow my head in prayer. And every good thing just came flashing back. And then I questioned myself, wait, you ever see Arnold do anything bad? You ever hear Arnold talk anything bad? And then I realized, what a friend we have lost. I'm not going to be long, but may I say this? Teach your children, most of you here knows Arnold well. Bring up your children that way. Eh? It would make the world a more loving and pleasant place. May Arnold rest in peace.
right. As you can see on this, on the program sheet, we are asking all the other special tributes to flow in this order. We're going to have Sister Elizabeth Bullock, then Brother O'Neill Henry, then Sister Marvin King. Thank you very much for it.
Good morning, everyone. So I will be presenting this tribute on behalf of my daddy, Brother Hilford Bullock. He says, I first met Arnold when he was a Form 1 student at the Maracua Secondary School, St. Joseph Convent, Maracua now. At that time, I would have been in Form 3. I remember him to be a calm and humble boy, never finding himself in untoward mischief, but always cheerful and easygoing with his peers. Much like myself, he enjoyed cricket and was a very good cricketer. We played many cricket matches together, being part of the same team. We would play against other schools and teams in and around St. Vincent, even after our school days. I remember him to be a good wicketkeeper and batsman with a ready team spirit and sportsmanship. And he was always ready to lend a helping hand. I remember we had an upcoming match and I was supposed to bat, but had no padding gear. I asked Arnold if I could borrow his, and without hesitating, he was already handing them over, asking, "You want the bat to use too?" Being captain many times, there were always more guys who wanted to be part of the team, more than the 11 that is allowed. But one thing I always ensured, that Arnold was always on my team because of his team spirit and outstanding sportsmanship. One of the fondest boyhood memories of him was his good deportment in school. On many occasions, our strict principal would inspect the students to see how they carried themselves and represented the school uniform, as was the custom of many students, and especially the boys in those days. Bare feet were common, hair not properly groomed, and uniforms were unkempt. On one of these inspection days, however, from the crowd of us students, the principal singled out Arnold and called him up to the stage. Then he turned to us, all eyes on Arnold, as she began her demonstration. "You see, students, this is how I want you to dress. Look at how Arnold represents himself in the uniform. Hair well combed and neat, shirt in his pants, correct color socks, shoes on his feet, and well shined. This is the perfect example of how a Maracua Secondary School student should look. I hope you take example." She then proceeded to identify all the flaws in the attire of other students, male and female alike. Meanwhile, Arnold was beaming from ear to ear of his accolades that day. As time progressed and we grew into young adults, he was aware of my courtship with Donna, my late wife, and would always greet me anytime I was on my way to visit her in Richland Park. Being on the search for a lady himself, he would tease me about giving him my secret on how to land an Adventist girl, as he was Adventist, but I was not at the time, and Donna was. After Donna and I got married and the years went on, I would always remember Arnold's appreciation towards my family and myself. Whenever we came to church, he was such a warm and welcoming face to look forward to. As I'd sit listening to the service, I would feel a little pat on my head or someone playing with my ears, and immediately I'd know it was him. There was not a Sabbath where we didn't attend church, and once Arnold was there, his warm and mischievous greetings would always bring that familiarity of our boyhood days and his appreciation of my wife and children. He would eagerly ask how the family was keeping and always share his kind words and best regards. Be it simple as they were, I would never forget these encounters, as I could always count on Arnold to make me feel welcomed and appreciated wherever we met. Rest in peace, Arnold, my brother. You are deeply missed by me. And now from myself, I've known Arnold since I was a small child in church. It would always bring a smile to my face whenever I saw his playful greetings to my parents, which he also rolled over to me. He was that cheerful character I would look forward to seeing whenever I attended church, from a little child right up to my current adult years. He is what I would describe as a gentle giant. I will miss his humble and cheerful demeanor. And now to you, Donald, from one grieving child to another, I sympathize with you and your family. I know this is not an easy time, and I can't guarantee when it will feel easier to have lost such a wonderful parent that was so very integral to your life. What I can do, however, is to share with you some things that help to bring me comfort, especially on difficult days, and I hope they can for you. One, your father loved and lived for Jesus, and he taught you about Jesus and his love. And today there are so many children who are robbed of this. And you can hold steadfast to that promise of the second resurrection and seeing him again. Two, your father loved you. He sacrificed, encouraged, and was there for you. Three, he was proud of you, of what you achieved, how you honored him while he was alive. Know that he died with pride in his heart, that you made him proud. Four, you both had a close and loving relationship with each other. So many children today are born and grow to adulthood without a parent, while others have grown with their parents and still long to have experienced that parental bond, guidance, and love. Consider yourself privileged to have experienced your father's love and the values he instilled in you. Five, he gave you the very best of himself that he could, that his means allowed. And six, as much as you want him back with you, God saw that he would have done his part here on earth, and he is now free from a world of toil, pain, and sorrow, and is now simply resting until Christ returns. And you know, this year, a lot of my friends and colleagues have also lost their parents too. And as I speak from my personal experience here and those of others, I can assure you that for children who have shared that deep, loving connection with a parent, you can resonate with these points. The relationship that you both shared, it cannot be replaced or replicated, but it was foundational. The responsibility is now yours to do your best with what your father has left in you. Let him live on in your thoughts, actions, words, and values, in the way you live, how you raise your family, and your interaction with others. That's how you keep him alive. Stay hopeful, stay blessed, and continue to trust in God for his comfort and strength.
Good morning, church. Good morning. This is a tribute not to Arnold, but for him, and a timely word of advice to us. He was not a teacher, but today he is teaching us the biggest lesson of life. We all must die until Christ's return. So we all have to make our calling and election show. Arnold was a good-natured man. I've never seen him vex, was never engaged in an argument or raise his voice at anyone. Not filled with false pride, he was easygoing and took his time to do what he wants. He was a jovial person to those he knew and trusted. A pig become something else, adjective. You know how you describe a fowl, a dog. So Arnold will put that description to a pig, okay? I want to say more about that. Arnold was a good cricketer and a wicketkeeper. He was involved in two young boys' cricket teams in Richland Park, namely the Zambo boys, boys mainly below the school, and some here and there above the road, and the Kent boys. That was more from guys from the Riverside and wrong by the square, wrong by Davis Square. And in matches between the two teams, and I'll always play for Kent Boys. Never play, unless he was a member for the Zambu Boys, he never played for Zambu. And when we run through the side, and I was the only one to hold us up and snatch victory from us. He was more privileged than us financially, due mainly to his stepfather, Mr. George Charles, of blessed memory. As a team, we found it difficult to buy cricket gears. We used to chump 25 or 50 cents per month to buy bats, two bats. Then we had to aisle them with linseed. Arnold, on the other hand, brandishing his own bat and other cricket gears. He soon joined the ranks of the much-famed Saints cricket team as an opener. He attended the St. Joseph's Convent, Maracua, commonly referred to at that time as Sister School. He preceded me there, and on my entry there, he brought a pair of boxing gloves for me, knowing that I used to do a lot of sparring with older fellas than myself. He used to imitate Muhammad Ali and his slang, fly like a butterfly and sting like a bee. In his sporting days, Arnold no doubt had faced many deliveries and survived many, many difficult ones, not only in sports. On the 22nd November 2021, he was defeated by a last unplayable delivery. May his soul rest in peace.
Friends, loved ones, and family, on behalf of my brother Walter and the rest of the King family of Hopewell, it is an honor and privilege for me to pay tribute today to Arnold Charles. Arnold was a very close friend of Walter from since school days, where they played cricket together. Their friendship continues up until his death. At church, they sit together in this row at the back, the last bench. Both of them would sit together. And on Sabbath morning, when Walter is going to church and Arnold is on the way, he will take Walter to church if he has a seat available. If not, Walter was so sorry that Arnold had to walk to church. If Walter is not at church on a Sabbath day, Arnold will call when he gets home to find out if Walter is okay or what's the problem. When Arnold is unable to make it to church, he will stand by the road, wait till Walter reach by his gate, and hand Walter his tithes and offering to take to church. He was such a good Christian man. Arnold was truly a great person, cheerful, loving, and friendly. He was indeed a true friend. To the family and friends of Arnold, while there is no way we can feel your pain, we do feel your loss. Arnold will be missed, gone but not forgotten. May his soul rest in peace.
All right, next we have Mrs. Gerlin McGill. I was searching my eyes. I'm not too sure if she's here with us. Okay, she's not here this time. And the other tribute, we'll leave this one for later on. which will be done by our first elder, the Richmond Park Estate Church. So right now what we are going to do, we're going to open up the floor for those who wish to give tribute. But before we do that, we're just going to sing one or two verses of the song, number 530, it is well with my soul. So let's sing, and if you wish to give tribute, you will come forward. Give tributes at this time, please come forward. All right, we'll keep on singing. I guess when you're ready, if you're ready, you will just come forward. So let's sing the second verse.
I sing.
Anybody? All right, we have someone coming there now.
Pleasant good morning to everyone.
I know I cannot sit in my seat and don't say anything about Arnold this morning. Arnold Charles was a very great man. You can ask him for anything and he will not say no. If nobody in your life ever hug you, just as long as Arnold come close to you, be sure that he's going to get a hug. And he will always make sure he have a smile on his face and make sure that everybody is good. And I must say to my brother, I know your daddy's not here for you anymore, but you just have to stay strong and continue to pray God, and I know God will see you through, and you and your family. And I know this morning my mom would like to be here, but she's in Aruba. And I know Anala has been not only just a close friend to her, but someone that he always loved and always will be there for. So this morning, on behalf of my mother, she would just like to say thanks for everyone who has been here for her son in this time. And may the Lord continue to bless each and every one of us here as we go through this moment. Amen.
I must have the Savior with me, for I did not walk alone. I must feel His presence near me, and His arms around me thrown. Then my soul shall feel no ill. Let Him lead me where He will. I will go without a mama, and His footsteps follow still. I must have the same
Trust.
Special song on behalf of the family at this time. We want to close this section so that the next segment may continue at this time. God bless.
Good morning, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. Today, we are here to celebrate the life of Brother Arnold Richard Charles. What a life and what an individual that we would have sat a couple of minutes ago and listened all the tributes given about him. And I am just going to speak on behalf of the church, the Richland Park Seventh-day Adventist Church, of which he is a member. Well, was a member. Today will be his last day here, but we'll look forward to that day when we all will see Jesus and meet one another again. Would you want to meet him again, especially all his friends and family and his well-wishers? I want to meet him, but I can only do that if we remain faithful to Jesus. What do you say? We can only meet one another, especially those we love so dearly, when we obey and do the will of God. And when he bursts the clouds, we will see him. As a member of the Richland Park Church, Brother Charles was very supportive in every aspect. Now, initially, he was very shy. Of all the, you know, he's good at cricket, he's good at that. But when he came to church and to stand in front and to do something, you know, he'll prefer the back seat. But don't believe because he's sitting in the back that he's not supportive. Anything you ask him to do besides coming up here, well, he's at the front, all right? But just the fact to come here and speak. I, as an individual and has been, you know, part of the church for a long time, he was a deacon, a committed deacon. And when he was active, you sometimes can number. We have a planned program. We ask for the men to come out and support. And you can bet, and you know those who would be there And Brother Charles is one that you can count on. You know for sure he's going to show up, he's going to support. And if he's not going to be there, he's finding, he'll making sure, like a week before, days before, to let you know the reason why he would not be able to make it. And that is special. Huh? You know, like some of us wait until 1 minute before to call and say, I can't make it. That was never Brother Charles. He let you know. And more importantly, if he could make it, he has to do something to ensure that he said to you, I am supporting. Huh? So for example, we're helping somebody and he can't make it, he's going to pay for the juice, the food or something. Yeah? And that is Brother Charles. So he, one way or the other, he's supporting. And we really, I'm just saying those things that wasn't said before and from the church's point of view. And financially, the church is going to, what do I say, Pastor? Financially, the church is going to, I hope we'll be able to balance our budget. But God is good. God is good. And we want to extend to all the son and extended family, Sister Simon and her entire family and all the other relatives, our deepest sympathy from the church, from the Richland Park Seventh-day Adventist Church. We are going to miss him. And the church is really going to sit down and pay attention to those words that were said of his quiet, meek demeanor. And we just, if for those who study, we have for Seventh-day Adventists, we have a lesson quarterly that we use to study every day. And do you know what today spoke about? To use that Seventh-day Adventist, and you will join us. You're not Seventh-day Adventist, you can join us so you can follow this instruction as well. The instruction is that we must always operate with heaven currency. And what is heaven's currency? To be graceful, to think before we speak, not to be harsh. Those are exactly, read it. If you're living next to a Seventh-day Adventist, ask them to show you today's lesson. And that's exactly what is in there. And everything that was said about Brother Charles is what the lesson is speaking. And he lived that. I cannot say I lived that. You trouble me, you talk to me too hard, I'll let you have it. Huh? But I can say to you, and from what we've all heard, Brother Charles, leave it. And from my own family, my mother wants to extend deepest sympathy to the family. Fairly close, just on the hill down below. And what about the cricketing? I'm living next to the playing field, and when Arnold going up, he and what's his name? Joson. He died. Somebody remind me his name. O'Neill. Give me the correct name. Neil Williams. Yes, when himself and Neil Williams going up to play. I am the little boy who was up there to go and feel. So my attachment to Arnold was from those days, and not only that, when he, after, you know, walking and doing his chores at home, and he leaves home to come up to the chaperone at junction there, he walks fast. And as a little boy, I took you know, myself and him had fun. Anytime he passed, I would come up behind him and try to keep up with him until I reached by Jax. When I reached Jax, I turned back. I said, "You go on, man. I can't keep up with you." And every single day, it was just like that. And we had that bond. And I will certainly miss Brother Charles. The bond continued. Whenever he had, the church requested anything and he needs some advice, he will call and he speak to me and ask, "Well, what do I think of what we need?" And that was the kind of relationship we had. And on behalf, for myself and my family, I want to, you know, extend deepest sympathy to the entire family. And we, as I said, we all look forward to that day when we will meet each other again. We will continue with the use of him. The golden morning is fast approaching. Jesus soon will come to take his faithful and happy children to their promised. Let's all stand, blend our voices, and sing.
The golden morning is fast approaching. Jesus soon will come.
Thank you for life. Thank you that you are the resurrection and life. Today we come to celebrate the life of our departing brother. Father, we could never get accustomed to death. Lord, help us, O Father, that when the day comes, when you shall come to put in your appearance, we will see you. And oh Father, when death shall die, we will go home to live with you. Father, we just want to thank you again for the life you lived, and oh God, that the legacy that you would have left be with us as we celebrate his life today. I pray for the bereaved family. Oh God, be with them today as they be comforted. And I pray, oh God, your Holy Spirit would abide with them. I pray that today, that whatever is said and done today, that your Holy Spirit will be with us and take control of today's proceedings, we pray. This I ask in your Son's name.
The scripture reading is taken from Revelation 21 and verse 4. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away.
I wish to publicly express my condolences to the family. Donald, who is very much a brother to me, and to all the other family members who are here, friends, you know, of the family, my deepest condolences. This song I'm about to sing is by special request of the family.
I heard a sound of a mighty rushing wind, and it's closer now than it's ever been. I can almost hear the trumpet. Songs the call at a midnight cry. We'll be going home when Jesus steps up and a cloud to call his children. Dead in Christ shall rise to meet him in the air. And then those that remain will be quickly changed. Oh, at midnight, when Jesus comes again. See, I look around me, I see prophecies fulfilling. And the signs of the times, they're appearing everywhere. I can almost hear the Father children for at a midnight cry. We'll be going home when Jesus steps on and the clouds to call his children. Oh, the dead in Christ shall rise to meet him in the midnight cry when Jesus comes again. And then those that remain will be quickly changed at a midnight cry. At a midnight cry, we'll be going home, going home.
The second scripture reading will be taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. Here begin it. But I will not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words.
Morning, church. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. And we are here to celebrate life. You know, it is sad at this moment, but when you think about it, it is also joyful. Knowing that one day we will be like Arnold, whether in a casket or a coffin, whatever it is. But we know that one day we all will hear the trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall be raised for us. So let us all behold, I behold each and every one, take stock of our lives. Because life is so short these days. So let us look up because our redemption is right now. This song is by special request by the family. I'm kind of homesick for a country.
Elder Leon Adams, Elder Chet Thompson, Elder Leotone Miller, Pastor Sylvan Samuel, brothers and sisters, good morning. I share with you two passages of scripture which I believe are very apt on this occasion. The first is from Ecclesiastes 3. There's a time for everything and a reason for every activity under the heavens. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to reap. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather them. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to search and a time to give up searching. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to mend. A time to be silent and a time to speak out. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. Then there is the comfort that God's Son, Jesus Christ, gave to his disciples when he bade them farewell, as is written in the Gospel of John, chapter 14, in which it said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's kingdom, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, so that where I am, there you will be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way you know." Disciple Thomas said, "Lord, we know not where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus replied, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but through me." I quote those scripture readings because I know that George and Veronica Charles, the parents, brought up and nurtured their only son, Arnold Charles, in a Christian home with love for God and his son, Jesus Christ, and with respect for his fellow men. Those scripture readings are also valuable lessons to all of us. Ecclesiastes 3 reminds us of the different stages of life. John chapter 14 confirms that God has provided a better home and a much happier way of life in his beautiful kingdom in heaven. George and Veronica Charles died several years ago, but they were able to guide their son Arnold, to mold his young mind, and to develop him into the fine human being that we all knew and loved. The teaching, guidance, and love he received from his parents obviously left a lifelong impression on Arnold, because throughout his 65 years, he never strayed from the well-rounded physical and spiritual nurturing that he received from his parents. As a teenager, Arnold was first baptized in this church. He was rebaptized as an adult on the 15th of August, 1998. It was here that he worshipped and served as a deacon at one stage. Arnold was born in Trinidad and Tobago. He came to St. Vincent as a child and grew up in the Hopewell and Richland Park communities, where he attended the Richland Park Seventh-day Adventist Primary School and gained his secondary education at the Mountain View Academy, now St. Joseph's Convent, Mariacourt. He was an only child, and as one would expect, he was showered with love by his parents to the same extent that he loved his only son, Danol, his three grandchildren, and all members of his immediate and extended families. His immediate family includes his son, Donald, daughter-in-law, Dahlia, grandchildren, Anel, Kalia, and Donald Jr., his uncle, Alvin Simon, in Trinidad, his aunt, Rebecca Simon, who cared for him, and his dear first cousin, Elaine Simon Latham.
His uncle Simon is very advanced in age, and it was not possible for him to travel to St. Vincent to pay his last respects to his nephew. Arnold's many cousins, other relatives and friends are too many to list at this time. Arnold had a very deep love and respect for the friends he made along life's way, and they in turn held him in great esteem, admired the manner in which he carried himself, and the love and respect he showed for family and friends. He always greeted everyone with warmth. As for the ladies, they received special hugs and kisses on their cheeks. Arnold's generosity had no bounds. His mother put him in charge of the family shop at Junction here in Richland Park. And when she thought business was booming because stocks never stayed long on the shelves, the income from sales did not match the turnover of goods. It was Arnold's generosity that caused the shelves to be empty and the income to be low. He was kind-hearted and always willing to help someone in need. Arnold and his only son, Donald, enjoyed a very close and dear relationship. He always encouraged his son to read and spoke to him about life and the proper way he should live it. They watched television together quite often, especially when the West Indies cricket team was playing. As with many West Indians, Arnold was extremely passionate about cricket and would become very angry when the West Indies lost. This happened too often for his liking. Donald said that by watching so much cricket with his dad, he became intrigued by the game and dreamed of becoming a cricketer in the same way that it was Arnold's ambition to one day play for the West Indies. As a young man, Arnold, like his father George, had a passion for cricket. I developed a great friendship with George when I worked as an executive at the St. Vincent Banana Growers Association. The then manager of the association, the late Frank Williams, and I visited George whenever we went on field trips. It was George who introduced me to Arnold. He asked me to help him with his cricket, and I invited Arnold to play in the National Cricket Championships with Saints Cricket Club, of which I was captain. It was a decision I have never regretted. Arnold was one of our most dependable members. He was always on time for matches and was a stubborn and competent opening batsman who played some very outstanding and useful innings for Saints Club in the National First Division and or the Premier Division Cricket Championship. He impressed me with his high level of discipline, his work ethics, and his loyalty to the club. On behalf of the club, some of whose members may be here this morning, I thank Arnold for his valuable contribution to the club's development and extend deepest condolences to his family. Arnold's death came as a shock to everyone. He had a big physical presence. That came from his weakness for delicious food. He was cool by nature. Nothing seemed to bother him. Whenever the family faced challenging situations, Arnold's response would be extremely calm, and he would say simply, "Huh, where you say all?" He never forgot to telephone a family members to convey very best wishes on special occasions, such as birthdays, Mother's Day, Father's Day, and Christmas. Arnold fell ill on the 8th of last month and was rushed to the Levi Latham Health Center. He was diagnosed with COVID-19, discharged from hospital, but was confined to bed at home, where he died peacefully on the 22nd of November. God graciously allowed us to share Arnold's life for 65 years. Thank you, Lord. All of us at this service will forever treasure the life of Arnold Charles. We thank God for letting us enjoy him, even though his time on earth seemed too short. It could be that the Almighty felt that Arnold had already made such an impact on our lives and that it was time for him to take his place among the angels. The Lord give it, and the Lord take it away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Now his soul has been taken to a higher calling in God's family, in a room in the heavenly mansion which God has promised to all of those who believe in him and his son Jesus Christ. His body shall be laid to rest after this service. So long there, Arnold. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. May the blessings of God rest and abide with us all. May his gracious mercies comfort us at this time of grief and sadness. And may he grant us the strength to cope with our loss. God bless us all.
Good morning, church. This song I'm about to sing was specially requested by the Campins family and the Simons family on the passing of Arnold for the comfort and peace they need to get this morning. I hope I can really sing it.
And I see all my friends in Hallelujah Square. What a wonderful time we'll all have up there. Yes, we sing and praise Jesus, his glory to share. And we'll not see a blind man. And we'll not see a crippled man in a Hallelujah. see all my friends
in a hallelujah square.
What a wonderful time we'll all have up there.
Yes, we sing and praise Jesus, His glory to share. And we'll not see a blind man in a hallelujah square. See a crippled man in a hallelujah square.
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters. Thank you, Sister Brother Desmond and Sister Bacchus, for reminding us that in Hallelujah Square, there'll be no blind man, no crippled man, no lame man, no man who is helpless. I want to join with Elder Chet Thompson, the first elder for this church, and on behalf of the entire membership, and by extension, the Maracua East District, express sympathy to the son, Donald, and his family, children, nieces and nephews, sisters and brothers, close relatives, and the passing of their brother, Arnold Charles. I came to know Arnold Charles while here as a pastor for the church. And as far as I could remember, Arnold Charles, Brother Charles, was a very quiet individual, pleasant, peaceful disposition. Sat at the back, as was said earlier, never seemed to be bothered about anything. Truth be told, as much as I know, all of us will die, I was surprised to hear of his passing. For I never knew Arnold to be sick or struggling with some life-threatening issue. So to pass so suddenly by virtue of the circumstances was really heartbreaking. Sometimes we wish we had a power over death, you know? Sometimes we just wish we could have changed things and make them different. You know, and I ask myself several times, as Paul argued with those skeptics and doubters in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, about verse 17 there, about that entire chapter almost, where Paul said to them that if Jesus Christ has not been risen from the dead, if Jesus is not resurrected, and we preach that Jesus is resurrected from the dead, then we are false witnesses of Jesus Christ. And your faith is vain, and our faith is vain. And if only in this life we have hope, then we are of all men most miserable. And as you know, the scripture much better than I do, I presume. When Paul said that we are of most men most miserable, Paul was speaking to the Christians, those who believe that Jesus Christ has been resurrected, ascended, and is coming again. Because if you don't believe that, then you have nothing to be disappointed about. But those of us who believe that Jesus died, rose again, and will come one day, if he does not come, then we will be disappointed. And you know, I said to myself, without that promise of Christ coming, what hope do we have beyond the grave? That promise, that sure promise of Christ's second coming, makes all the difference and mean everything to our faith. My encouragement to you, my dear brother, is to continue to hold on to that promise. I think I can say without reservation, as far as I know, Brother Arnold was a good man, a faithful man, and he would have made his part right with the Lord. So let's continue to be faithful and hope that we would see him one of these good days. I want to share with us for the next 10 minutes or so a message entitled, Jesus Shares Our Feelings. Jesus Shares Our Feelings. I am reading from Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 to 16. And I am reading from the New International Version. Let me read what is on the screen as it is posted. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. Now underscore that word, hold fast. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all point tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come how? Boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. In these verses, the invitation of rest in Jesus is extended further by providing three principal reasons that this rest in Jesus that Arnold is experiencing and will, in the true sense of the word, eventually experience, is possible for all believers. Let me go that over. In the verses that we've just read, the invitation of rest in Jesus is extended further by providing three principal reasons that this rest in Jesus is possible for all believers. One, Christ is our high priest. Two, he is touched with the feelings of our infirmities. And three, he has grace and mercy available to all who need them. Shall we pray? Loving Father, we thank you in the midst of all our loss, in the midst of our grief. We thank you because you are the resurrection and you are the life. And it is in you we live and move and have our beings. We thank you for life beyond the grave. You have conquered death. You conquered the grave. And you have the keys of hell and death. And one day, it is our hope that that day would be soon, you will come. And at the sound of the trumpet, the dead in Christ shall be resurrected, and we will be reconciled with our loved ones. Thank you for that hope, O God. Today we ask that your presence would be felt and experienced in every heart. And as we tabernacle for the next few minutes, may we open our hearts to hear from you as you speak to us. May your presence be our guide. May we know for sure that Jesus is our Savior. Forgive my sins, my doubts and apprehensions. Speak to me and through me, and let your will be done and your name alone be lifted up. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. First of all, one, Christ is our high priest, according to the passage and the review. Christ as our high priest. First of all, Paul acknowledged the reality that professed Christians could recant their faith or stop believing in God. Tomorrow I can decide not to come to church anymore. I can stop believing God. And many have done that. And Paul acknowledged this reality. And given that possibility, and as a means of encouragement and reassurance, he points the Christians to Christ's mediatorial function in the heavenly sanctuary on their behalf. Because the work of redemption did not complete at the cross. Are you still with me? The plan of salvation did not climax at the cross. It continues in heaven. And so Paul points the Christian to Christ's mediatorial function in the heavenly sanctuary on their behalf, in his dual role as priest and high priest. Christ mediates on behalf of all those who accept his death as the only atoning sacrifice for their sins. And for the circumstances that confront us on a daily basis, it is reassuring to know that we have someone who behind the scenes, as Ellen G. White says, is working out the counsels of his own will. And in the interests of all those who are faithful to him. And so Paul made it unequivocally clear to the Christian, in the event that they doubt, have become apprehensive about their salvation and what Christ has accomplished for them, my dear brother. Paul reminded the Christian believers, you and I, today, as he did back then, that we have a high priest. And I like you, if possible, to envision the Levitical system in the Jewish history. In Jewish economy. What did the high priest do? The high priest in the Jewish Levitical system mediate in the sanctuary on behalf of the people. The prophet represented God to the people. But the priest represented the people to God. And Paul warned the Christian to get this concept and see that, like the earthly priest, Jesus Christ is our high priest. Not only is he the high priest, but he's also the sacrifice. He plays a dual role. And Paul says that he's in the heavenly sanctuary right this very minute, mediating on your behalf, on my behalf, on our behalf. If you know him as Lord and faithful Savior. And Brother Arnold Charles knew that very well. That's why he came to church faithfully. That's why he came to church willingly. That's why he came to church in confidence, because he knew he had an high priest who is standing in the heavenly sanctuary like a lawyer who pleads his case for him when he could not plead for himself. Can I talk to you a little bit?
Now in earthly matters, we seek legal service, don't we? If someone is quarreling for your property and you know you have legal right to that property, you check a lawyer as fast as you can. You take that deed with your name written on it in black and white and present it to the lawyer. Let him know that someone is contending with you for what is legally yours, and your lawyer stands in court on your behalf. He acts just like the high priest. Christ sees the anguish of our penitent hearts, Brother Donald. He hears our cries for mercy. He knows our circumstances. Christ feels your pain and your anguish. And I cannot say I understand how you feel, but Christ knows how you feel. He understands your suffering and your grief. Are you still home? He sees all the misfortunes that beset our part. Christ understands. Help me, Lord, guide my thoughts. As our lawyer, priest, and high priest, he pleads our case before his Father. He represents our interests before the court of heaven. Let me tell you something, brother Donald. Let me say something, brothers and sisters. You can pay a lawyer thousands of dollars to represent your case at court. And you're not even sure the lawyer will win your case for you. And some lawyers, I don't like to deal with lawyers. I tell you the honest truth, I don't like to deal with lawyers. I try my best to avoid lawyers. Because I find some lawyers take advantage of you. They push you wrong because they know the law and you don't know it. They push you wrong. And push you wrong and you have to go every time you go, you have to pay more. So I try to avoid lawyers. But you might consult a lawyer and you're not sure that your lawyer would win your case for you. But ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you one thing. There is a lawyer who have never lost a case. There is a lawyer who have never lost a case. And Daniel's case has been secured with the Lord. And his case is fixed in heaven. And his lawyer, Jesus Christ, his high priest, has plead his case for him. Stand before the Father, pleading his case for him. And when Jesus presented Daniel's name, Arnold's name before the throne of heaven, and Satan accuses Arnold of something, Jesus stands up. Can I talk to you? Jesus stands up and says, look, Arnold might have made mistake. Arnold might have done wrong, but Arnold accepted me. And Arnold is right in the book of heaven. Can I keep you a little longer? Arnold is right in the book of heaven. Rest assured, God, Christ has gained victory for Arnold. Oh, hallelujah, Lord. Forgive my weak use of thy strength. Jesus, our high priest, cares for us. We are not left to face life difficulties all alone. Sometimes you feel alone. I got up this morning, opened my bedroom door, went into my kitchen, and I saw a sight that broke my heart. And in this moment, Ella Thompson, you feel like following your own inclination. But you remember, you have someone who is pleading your case for you. You have someone who cares for you. Someone who loves you. Someone who concerned about your difficulties and your circumstances. And so I want to encourage you, my dear brother, continue to trust the Lord. Jesus, our high priest, has pleaded Arnold's case, and his victory is sure. So you are never left to face life troubles alone. We have a high priest who cares for us. If ever you and I need a reason to hold fast to a profession, Paul says, if ever you need a reason to hold fast to your profession, or what we believe here it is that Christ, our high priest, is in the heavenly sanctuary working out our salvation. This is precisely the reason Paul admonishes us in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23. He said, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. For he is faithful that promise you attempted to give up, and the burden seems difficult, and the road seems long, and your heart aches sometimes, and you feel like throwing in the towel. But Paul is saying, keep believing. Be confident. Your high priest is in the heavenly sanctuary, and he's working it all out for you. You know, I love the way Ellen G. White puts it. She said, in the annals of human history, the growth of nation, the rise and fall of empires, appears dependent upon the will and the prowess of men. The shaping of events seems to a great degree to be dependent upon his promise. The shaping of events seems to a great degree to be dependent upon his promise. How does it go again? But in the word of God, the curtain is drawn aside, and we behold above, behind, and through all the play and counterplay of human interest and power and passion, the agencies of the all-merciful one, silently, patiently working out the counsels of his own will. You might not see it, I might not see it, but behind the scenes, God is working it out for your good and for my good. So despite the loss, despite the grief, despite the difficulties, despite the brokenness, you can still hold on to that promise, because you know that promise is steadfast and sure. And one of these good days, it will come to fusion. One of these good days, we'll see our brother again. Oh, what a day that will be. What a day that will be. You know, Paul said, listen, Jesus is fit to represent us in the heavenly sanctuary because he came down as human being and took on humanity. Stay with me here. Let me bring this home right here. Paul said, listen, Jesus is more than qualified to represent us in the heavenly sanctuary because he's not a stranger to our condition. He's not isolated from our circumstances. He was human just like us. He lay off the robes of heaven and came down and took on human garbs. And he was tempted just like as we are. He was beaten and flogged and insulted and scorned and mocked and rejected and denied and crucified innocently. God knows what you are feeling. Christ knows what you are feeling because he was human being just like you. You know, they say only he in the kitchen do what? He in the kitchen feel the heat. Well, by way of analogy, we can say that to Christ. Christ was in the kitchen. He felt the heat, so he knows what we are feeling. Are you with me? We have not an high priest who cannot associate with our circumstances. Our high priest can associate with our circumstances. Paul says he was tempted just like we are tempted. He was tempted to give up. He was tempted to throw in the towel. You know the story in, you know it in Matthew chapter 4, when the devil came to Christ and tempted Christ. He said, if you are the what? Son of God, command that this stone be made bread. Command that this stone be made bread. If thou art the Son of God, throw thyself down. Jesus felt what you were feeling. So he knows our cares and our concern. If I was never divorced, I can't talk to you about the real realities of divorce. I might give you theory and some coping mechanism. But if you're really divorced and you've been through it, Elder Thompson, you've been through the storm, the tugging and the pulling and the twisting. You understand what I mean? If you've been through the storm and I come to you and said, Elder Thompson, my wife divorced me, you're in a position to sympathize with my feelings because you have been there. Jesus have been there. And he sympathized with our feelings, and he knows our grief and our loss. And today, my dear brother, I encourage you and the rest of your family to continue to be faithful. Cast not away, therefore, this confidence that you have. Don't recant your faith because you have someone who is vindicating your case for you. Jesus, our high priest, and one of these good days, he will take off that priestly robe. Are you still with me? One day soon, he will take off that priestly robe. And as was read in the scripture reading in 1 Thessalonians, he said that the Lord himself shall descend from heaven. When he takes off that priestly robe, he would declare, it is finished. It is done. The work of atonement is finished. And then Christ would come in all his glory and splendor. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and that morning breaks eternal, bright and fair, what a day that would be when our now is resurrected. When our loved ones are resurrected, and we are reunited together again, never more to be separated. Tears are wiped away. Revelation chapter 21 and verses 5 says, and God shall wipe away all tears from our eyes, and there shall be no more death, and no more sorrow, and no more pain, for the former things have passed away. Hallelujah. Do you believe that? Do you long for that day? Do you really long for that day? If you do, raise your hand wherever you are. I long for that day. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. There is hope for us beyond the grave. Jesus, our high priest, stands in the heavenly sanctuary. And he's pleading our case for us. He sees all that death has done to us, how it has break our hearts, deprive us of our loved ones, and leave us with an unanswered question. But today, I assure you, all is not lost. All is not lost. Do you know this song? I was sinking deep in sin. Brother Jack, could you locate it as we sing it? Love lifted me when nothing else could help. Love lifted me. Ready to stand as we sing this beautiful song. I was sinking deep in sin. Love lifted me. And as we sing, I invite the family. Come to the front if you, as we say a prayer for you. Love lifted me. In far from the peaceful shore, very deeply sinking to rise. But the master
heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now save from my.
Sing it like if you mean it.
Love lifted me. My soul bears songs, faith.
Jesus completely saved.
He will lift you by his love out of the angry wave.
He's the master of the sea. Bellows his will obey. He your Savior wants to be. He saved to thee. Love lifted me. Love lifted me.
When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Hallelujah. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
Your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed. Your heart is lifted heavenward. O thou King of saints, the God who judges every heart, before whom nothing is secret, the night and the day are both alike to you. David says, if I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. Where could we hide from your presence, dear Father? Everything about us is known to you. Thank you, God. Oh, dear brother, was the opening batsman in his team. He faced the new ball and he batted an entire innings. And now his innings has come to an end. And he has laid down his gears, packed them up, put them somewhere in the corner of his house. And those in the stand cheer and clap and wave as he scores sixes and four and twos and threes. But now, these are nothing but memories, oh God. But we know, oh God, that his name is written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. For he was a faithful player in his game of cricket and at church. And he played well and feel well and walk well and demonstrate Christian discipline at church and on the field. And you have seen it fit that he retire from this game and rest in you until that great getting up morning. Oh, what a day that will be for our dear brother. And now his son and his wife and children, we commit them to you. You know about them than even they know about themselves. The very thought that they are thinking, their heart experience, you know, God, what is happening in their mind right now. But we pray that you would encourage them to remain faithful and continue to be strong and live the life that you want them to live. May they find in you hope and comfort and joy. And know that even if they have lost their father, he has lost his father and father-in-law. Remind them that there is still you, their heavenly Father, and they can trust you and lift up their head unto the hills from whence cometh their help, because their help comes from the Lord which made heaven and earth. And you who have been with them up to this point will be with them whatever the future holds. So we commit them to you, dear Father, that you would guide them and protect them and keep them. And our dear brother Donald will walk in the way of the Lord and live a holy life, a life dedicated to you, consecrated to you, that just as his father had been an example to him, he would be by his life an example to his children. So all on Sunday would see that he is no ordinary man, but he's like a brand plucked out of the fire. Oh God, bless him in every regard. As a son, as a father, as a husband, and as priest in his home. Bless his wife as she stand by his side to give him support. As they reminisce on their deceased loved one memory
Oh God, I pray that you'd bind them together with cords of love that cannot be broken. And they would build on their father legacy, a life that is exemplary and worthy of imitation. Provide all of their needs, oh God, we pray. Guide them in all their endeavors. Nieces and nephews, sisters and brothers and close relatives, be with them as well as a bid farewell to a good relative and a good friend and a faithful brother. And they do so, Lord, not out of ignorance, but in faith that one of these good days their brother would be resurrected again. And Lord, it behoves each of us to make our calling an election show. For no man knows what tomorrow holds. Death and life is in the hands of the Lord. And Donald's passing is a reminder that one day, God, may we live wisely and soberly, watching and praying for your soon return, for the signs of all fulfilling, that the end of the world is near and Christ will come again. And we have this hope. We have this hope that burned down in our hearts. Hope in the coming of the Lord. May this be each of our hope. May this be every man's hope, every woman's hope, every child's hope. May we leave this sanctuary today, sure of our salvation. May each of us leave these walls this evening, sure of our salvation. Be confident that Jesus is our Savior. And tomorrow is not in our hands. Be glorified in everything, we praise you. In good times and in bad times, we praise you. In loss or in gain, we praise your holy name. In life or in death, we praise you because you are still God. Today and tomorrow, you are still the same. You could be trusted. You could be depended on. You are the everlasting Father, and you would never leave us alone. Thank you for your grace and your blessings as we commit the family to you. Grant them eternal peace. Grant them everlasting joy. May they know you individually and personally. And may they be able to say like Job, I know that my Redeemer live, and I will see him in the last day. Until such time, Lord, may you keep us in your providence and your grace, we pray. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit, let the church say, amen. Please remain seated. Family wish to have the vote of thanks at this time, and then that will be followed by the closing hymn and the closing prayer.
Good morning, everyone. Today, I would like to read a poem to you. But before I do so, I would like to say a special thank you for being with us today. Those who would have given tributes, thank you. Those who participated in the funeral service, send us cards, telephone calls, text messages, we read them all, and we say thank you. You know who you are. To Pastor Sylvan Samuel, Elder Callista Thompson, Mr. Trevor Lewis and family, Mr. Mike Finley, Mrs. Valera McKenzie, Mrs. Rona Gurley, and Mrs. Yvette Backus, the management and staff of the Memorial Funeral Home, thank you from the bottom of our hearts. Now I want to read a poem. It's entitled The Family Tree. A limb has fallen from the family tree. I hear a voice that whispers, grieve not for me. Remember the best times, the laughter, the songs, the good I lived while I was strong. Continue my heritage. I am counting on you. Keep on smiling. The sun will shine through. My mind is at ease. My soul is at rest. Remembering all how I was truly blessed. Continue traditions, no matter how small. Go on with your life. Don't stare at the wall. I missed you all dearly. So keep up your chin until that fine day we are together again. Rest in peace, Anna.
When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Our closing song, let's stand as we blend our voices together and sing our closing song. Father, we thank you for the blessings that we will have received this morning. And as we leave your courts to go to the place of final rest, we ask for your guidance, your protection. Continue to be with the family members and help that they will continue life with hope and in confidence that we all can see each other if we remain faithful to you. Thank you again, and bless us all as we depart, in Jesus' precious name.